How many of us have come this morning ready to be enlarged, amen, by God's word? Amen. Let me see your hands. If you're expectant, just lift your hands and say, Father, I'm ready to receive. I'm ready to be shifted. I'm ready to be enlarged this morning. Amen. Hallelujah.
Sure, making wise the simple, more to be desired than gold.
precious God. We thank you for your word, God. Amen. Good morning, family. My reading this morning is taken from Proverbs 2, from verses 1 to 15, and it's entitled, "The Pursuit of Wisdom Brings Security," and it reads, "My son, if you will receive my words and treasure my commandments within you, make your ear attentive to wisdom, incline your heart to understanding. For if you cry out for insight and raise your voice for understanding, if you seek her as silver and search for her as hidden treasures, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and discover the knowledge of God. For the Lord gives wisdom, and from his mouth come wisdom and understanding. He stores up sound wisdom for the upright. He is a shield for those who walk in integrity, guarding the paths of justice, and he watches over the way of his godly ones. Then you will discern righteousness, justice, and integrity in every good path. For wisdom will enter your heart, and knowledge will be delightful to your soul. Discretion will watch over you, understanding will guard you, to rescue you from the evil way, from a person who speaks perverse things, from those who leave the paths of uprightness to walk in the way of darkness, who delight in doing evil and rejoice in the perversity of evil, whose paths are crooked and are devious in their ways, to rescue you from the strange woman, from the foreign," Proverbs 15. Okay, in this chapter, we find that Proverbs 2 reflects courage, integrity, wisdom, and justice. Wisdom, as we know, is knowing and having discernment so we can apply the truth of the word of God at the right time, in the right way, and with the right motive. In our daily life situations, we are faced with issues, and sometimes the resolution to these situations appear to offer only a variety of bad options. This is where wisdom and discernment is required to determine which option presents the correct choice, or to recognize where a good option has been hidden. I'm reminded of Abigail in 1 Samuel 25, who demonstrated wisdom, discernment, and prudence in challenging circumstances and had the ability to navigate conflict with grace and integrity. We find Abigail demonstrated her wisdom by choosing her words carefully, acknowledging David's rightful position, and her hospitality fostered goodwill. Her discernment prevented David from acting rashly towards her family. Her prudence served as a shield that safeguarded her household and community from harm. Abigail had every right to nag her folly, husband of folly, but wisdom kept her mouth shut. If we are to conquer the trials of our life, we need to do so with the mind of God, using his wisdom and thereby solving problems with God and not on our own. So family, as we use the case study of Abigail in our own personal life, where we can use the wisdom of God to diffuse any situation and challenge that we may face, remember, with God's wisdom, all things are possible. Mm. Let us pray. Amen. Our Father God in heaven, we come to you with a grateful heart. We thank you, Lord, for your wisdom, for your love, for your guidance and your grace. Father, we know that daily, Father, we are faced with things where wisdom is required. And we feel like our backs are against the wall, we don't know what to say. But we trust you, Father, to put the words into our mouth, that our actions will be correct as well. We just thank you, Lord, for wisdom. And we just pray, Father, as we go forth this week, we will go out in your wisdom. Today, Father, we just thank you for the gathering of our family. We thank you, Lord, for the praise and worship team. We just pray your best each singer and the musicians and even the technicians at the back, Lord. And Father, we bring before your Papa as well, Lord, bring forth your word. We pray, Father, for an open mind and receptive hearts to receive what you have to say, O God. And Father, as we receive what you say, Father, let us, Father, live the life that we are being told this morning, O Lord. We just thank you now, Father, for everything that's going to happen this morning. And Father, we come with one heart, Father. We just make your praise glorious. And we say thank you, Abba Father, for you are great and greatly to be praised. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, family. He's the God of Abraham, he's the God of Isaac, and he's the God of Jacob. But he's our God, amen? Just tell your neighbor, he's our God. He's a covenant-keeping God, amen? Tell somebody else, he's a covenant-keeping God.
You never leave me. You said that you won't forsake me. hands to Him. Same God, same God. Yesterday, today, forever the same. Moved in power then, move in power now. Provided then, providing now. Come on, tell Him, same God. Oh God, oh God, my God.
Shadows, a whisper of light, and the Thank you.
Soccer field with the ball running through everybody and finally score, you lose your mind, right? Go wild in your lounge. Some people break TVs, etc. Think of the profundity of God's word. That's how I feel. It's like Messi has scored a goal. I think of the loveliness of God's word. Psalm David said, I lift up my hands. What we've sung is actually a psalm. He said, forever, O Lord, your word is exalted, settled in the heavens. I lift up my hands to your commandments. Everyone do this, come on. I lift up my hands to your commandments and I praise the power thereof, the integrity, the profundity. Don't think you know what you have when you have God's word. Don't think the church realizes what we have when we have the word of the Lord with us. We love your word, Father. Love your word more than anything, more than life itself. We love your word. Teach us to meditate upon your word day and night. In it is the wisdom of God. In it is the counsel of the Lord. In it is the reason and the motive for our prosperity. They prosper that love your word. They prosper that meditate and do your commandments. So one more time, church, lift up your hands. We praise the power of your commands. Your commands are not burdensome. The word is near you, even in your mouth. Oh, Father, thank you that you still speak to us. Thank you that we have ears to hear communication from heaven. Your heart always speaking your thoughts in and through your word. We praise the power of you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you for your word. Thank you for the Bible. Thank you for the book of Proverbs. Thank you for all wisdom that we read daily. We bless you. Thank you for your counsel. Thank you for your rebuke. Thank you for your guidance, Lord. Thank you for your commands. Oh, we bless you. Come on, church, bless him. Just appreciate God for his word. Eternal word will never pass away. The grass will wither, the flower will fade, but the word of the Lord endureth forever and ever and ever. Oh, Father, oh, we magnify your name. Your covenant magnified, exalted along with your glory, rejoicing in promises. I meditate on your righteous way. Lift up those hands, come on. I lift up my receive the offering in this environment of loving God and loving his word. Amen. I want to encourage you to give freely and liberally as unto the Lord. God loves a cheerful giver. Amen. The buzzword right now amongst us is generosity. Everyone say generosity. Amen. I was back at the gym last night. More coaching and training. The two ladies in my life. And on our exit, I just ordered a smoothie, a peanut butter bomb. We're leaving the gym. And there was this lovely car guard. He's always there. So Renana was searching for, we didn't have any small change. And so she said, there's only a 50 here. I said, well, we have to give him something. You can't just leave. Yeah, so give him the 50. And so we gave him, and he was quite grateful. I want to encourage you, when you live in the spirit of generosity, you don't count the cost. I want to encourage you. Okay, yes, you want the word of the Lord today? Anybody want the word of the Lord today? Increase the tips in the car park, the car guards today. Just blow their minds. You know, it's more blessed to give than to receive. So let's receive the offering. And I know that the Lord is going to bless the cheerful and the generous giver. Everyone say the generous giver. The generous giver. Amen. And so lift up your hands to the Lord. Father, we thank you that we can give to you of our substance. Thank you, Lord, that we can worship you according to the commandment of your word. We've sung how excellent is your word, and your word commands us to live in this fashion. And so we've obeyed your word. We've obeyed your counsel. And Father, we want to bless you with our first fruits, our tithes, our offerings, our almsgiving, our giving to the poor, giving to those in need. May we be amongst the most generous people we know, I pray. In Jesus' name. Bless everyone, I pray. Let grace abound. Let grace be released now, Father. I pray in every life to do exceedingly, abundantly, more than what we can think or imagine. Your grace for every good work, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, family. A very warm welcome to each of you. It's so good to see everybody and gather together as one as we worship and receive from our Lord. A special welcome to our online viewers and an extra special welcome to those who are visiting with us for the first time. If you can stand as I call your name, we have Janae, Faid, and Emma. Let's give them a warm welcome. This is your Father's house. We trust that you will enjoy your time with us as we fellowship. You may be seated. The announcements for the week are as follows. There are no midweek services. However, you are all encouraged to stay in the Word and remain in meditation in our quest for wisdom. So today our reading is on Proverbs chapter 14. An exciting announcement for the youth, that those are persons between the ages of 13 and 20 years of age. The youth team has planned a hike for you, which will take place on Thursday. So parents, if you can take note of that, it will be on Thursday this week between 9 a.m. and 3 p.m. And further information for this will be posted on the youth group by the team. On Friday morning at 5:30 to 6 a.m. is our weekly prayer meeting, which will take place via Zoom. So you are encouraged to connect with that. And then on Saturday, the 24th, that's this week Saturday, between 3 and 5 p.m. is a high tea with Mama Renee. And this is for all the ladies. Sorry, guys. So ladies, registration is compulsory for this. So if you have not done so already, today, unfortunately, is the last opportunity for you to hand in your names to Mama Renee. And this is strictly for catering purposes. On Sunday, we will meet again. That's next week, Sunday, at 8:15 in this venue. So be bright and early. We are all enjoying coming together at 8:15 on a Sunday because it gives us a little time in the afternoons. And then finally, we want to just say, Newman, our condolences to you on the loss of your dear gran. As a family, we mourn with you and we pray that the Holy Spirit will continue to comfort you in the days ahead as you would mourn her loss. On a brighter note, we would like to wish the following people a happy birthday. Jewel, that's Jesse's daughter, Leah Gafur, and Ethan. They all celebrated this week, so a very happy birthday to you. We trust that you enjoyed celebrating the goodness of God. Immediately after church, we are all going to meet in the adjacent venue for fellowship. Even as we would build relationships, build a family, and join our graces, we pray that you would enjoy this tea that is before us, and also just enjoy each other, share in each other's wisdom and draw from each other. And we ask, there's been an appeal that we would proceed immediately after church and have a seat because there's something special planned. And then, who's ready for the word? Amen. We're all ready for the word. So Pastor Randolph, let's welcome Pastor Randolph.
Amen. Good morning. Carol's just reminding me, for those of you that need a copy of Pastor Lafoy's book, it's a kind of autobiography of his journey. Please put your name on the sheet. It's available at the welcome desk. I think it's 250 Rand. It's a very good read. He's been critical, a major, major figure in our lives, especially in our youth and young adult life. And it will be a very invaluable resource for you to have in your library. Amen. So please just put your name on it. The book will be launched at the National Conference at Dia Gloria, which is happening 2-3 weeks' time, I think. And so once that is done, we'll access the books through the local office here and get the books here to church. Amen. Well, the Sunday school, you may leave. Linda's going to be with you. Again, thank you to the teachers that take the time to prepare to minister to our young people. Amen. Amen. Once again, Newman, our sincere commiserations to you. We've been chatting throughout the week Newman's grand was buried on Friday in Zimbabwe, and Newman may make his way there in the week or two time, and we've chosen to finance his trip there and back. He couldn't be there in time, obviously, because of the quickness with which the funeral was arranged. But it was a grand that literally grew Newman up. It's like a kind of mother figure to him, very, very close to his heart. So just consistently bear him up in your thoughts and in your prayers. Amen. Today we're going to continue in the spirit of prayer. Today is part 15. In part 14, we spoke about, or the title was, A Prayer for Wisdom. A Prayer for Wisdom. And it's a slight departure on what I thought we would be dealing with in talking about prayer in this series. It comes off the back of Pastor Thamo's teaching on the Amorite spirit, where he said there were two kings, King Sion of Heshbon, that must be conquered, right, and King Og of Bashan. And the first one, King Sion of Heshbon. Heshbon means a place of reasoning, scheming, or strategy, strategic thinking. So it represents a kind of wisdom where you maneuver in life with very thoughtful, but with wise strategy for overcoming and for as the name of the king suggests, Sion means sweeping away, a warrior, one who overcomes, and he sweeps away by being strategic. Battles are won in the mind. Battles are won in the planning room when generals get together and they plan strategy. I love war historically based films. And often you see, like, you watch a Napoleon or Caesar, or even an Adolf Hitler. You'll watch him go into boardroom with these top generals. You'll see maps. You'll see strategy. You'll see a lot of planning before battles are engaged. Usually battles, they say, are either fought or lost or won in that room way before soldiers get onto the battlefield. King Sion of Heshbon was that kind of military strategist. And to counteract that, you need to possess. Everyone say possess. The place of scheming. Come on, say it. Possess the place of scheming. In other words, you've got to use your mind now, right? You've got to use your mind. You must remember, for 40 years they journeyed in the wilderness. There was not much they had to do to get daily provision. It simply fell from the sky. When they crossed the Jordan, the Bible says, and then the manna stopped. There's no daily provision where you do nothing. God says, now you go in. You dispossess and you possess. You plant vineyards, you sow seeds, and you generate harvest. There are things you have to do. And I think a lot of Christians just want provision to fall from heaven when God has given you strategy to receive it. For that, you're going to have to need wisdom. That's what we're focusing on wisdom. We got to be intelligent. We got to be savvy. We got to be sagacious, prudence, discreet. Maneuver, be shrewd in a good sense. I'm talking shrewdness in a positive sense. You go and you engage life and you become street smart and street wise with the wisdom of the heavens in how you do certain things. In Ephesians 5, verse 17, Paul prayed that God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, might give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. So the Holy Spirit is called the Spirit of wisdom. It's a spirit. Everyone say it's a spirit. It's literally the Holy Spirit in you. And we prayed this in the prayer meeting. James is very clear that if you lack it, James 1 verse 5, if anyone lacks wisdom, what must he do? Come on, talk to me. If you lack it, what must you do? You must simply ask. And what is God's disposition in giving you this wisdom? How does he give it? Everyone say generously. God will offload it, not in small bite-sized chunks. He will offload it in huge downloads of this stuff, right? So I'm going on a personal fast, which I would like the church to do if you inclined to this week, Tuesday and Wednesday. Give you a break on Thursday because it's a public holiday. Okay, the youth are marching, they're hiking somewhere. So if you would, I want you to cry unto the Lord. Everyone say, ask. There's something that is very good to pray and fast for. It is more wisdom. Pastor Thomas says every day he asks God for more wisdom because it's the key to life. So I'm trusting God for a generous download of wisdom. I'm going to seek the Lord and he will be found. I'm going to ask in faith, not being double-minded, and I will receive. Tell someone we will receive. Right? And there are certain areas which when I look at my own life, I lack that wisdom in certain spheres. And I'm saying, God, fill the gaps, fill the lack. Make me complete, okay? There just seems to be also, I said to you last week, in the current time, a huge emphasis on financial blessing attached to the gate global churches of which we are a part. Wisdom and wealth are powerful duos. Everyone say powerful duos. Wisdom and wealth are very, very powerful duos. Wisdom is the pathway to wealth. Wisdom is the way wealth will be sustained and wealth will be managed. God is not going to give you huge amounts of money to manage if you don't develop the cognitive skills to administrate it effectively, right? For example, if you are an impulsive spender, any impulsive spenders here? Some of you need, I can say, need to make an altar call right now. You don't need the thing, but because it was advertised and you saw the advert, you suddenly have a need for it. Or the impulse to buy is so reflexive. Impulsive buying is not just buying without planning to buy. It's more buying at a whim, irrespective of the inability to repay, especially if you buy on credit, right? But you must have the thing, and usually bedrock issues promote that. Things like self-image. So you got to have that brand name on you, no matter what the cost, because your image, how you carry yourself, is attached to that name. And so irrespective of the financial expenditure involved, you would rather impoverish yourself than to go without the brand name. Now that, for me, is bondage. What I'm saying is not to not buy brand names. I like brand names as well. And God will bless you so that you can buy the brand names. Tell someone you'll be a brand name buyer. You must. But you've got to be wealthy. You've got to be blessed to do that. But you don't derive your self-concept from those things. Those things don't make the person that you are. Okay? Your worth is internal. And so I want to encourage you to be wise in respect to understanding what God is doing in the Gate Global Churches presently. It's a Kairos season. Everyone say Kairos. It's an opportune moment where God is. Let me just say this. This year, remember there was 2 years in which that you deal with this Amorite issue, that to overcome, I think it was more than 30 cities if you read. Some versions say 60 in that Deuteronomy chapter 1, 2, 3, 4. Right? And that to overcome this. I prophetically believe that 2024, 2025 are like a 2-year period in which God is going to position you for financial ascendancy. Because you got to, after that, we've got to go up and go in and do the will of the Lord without fear for money, right? Without a fear of our lack of resource. And I want to encourage everyone to, in the next 2 years, please position yourself. And don't violate principles that will negate your reception of this kind of resource, right? Don't violate these principles. It's going to be very, very key that you understand the times and the seasons in which this teaching is situated, right? Please understand it fully. And then we spoke variously. I don't want to rehearse because of time. Let me just make one point here. I didn't get to teach it, but it's in your notes. Ecclesiastes 9:13 says, I came to see as wisdom under the sun, and it impressed me. There was a small city with a few men in it, and a great king came to it. surrounded it, and constructed large siege works against it. But there was found a poor wise man. Everyone say poor wise man. A poor wise man, and he delivered the city by his wisdom. Yet no one remembered that poor man. His wisdom wasn't matched with his prosperity. His poverty, although wise, and although he delivered a city from a great king because of his wisdom, the man was not remembered. Right? Legacy forgotten because of his financial state. Now, the text goes on. Let's read on. So I said, now this is the wise man Solomon speaking. So I said, wisdom is better than strength, because the king came in and poor man with wisdom delivered the city. Wisdom is better than strength, but the wisdom of the poor man is despised and his words are not heeded. So sometimes, although you are wise, your words are not heeded because you are poor. Now, you've got to meet the world where the world puts its highest sense of value or issues of credibility. The wealthy, it's amazing, the wealthy listen to the wealthy. The wealthy don't listen to the poor. And in terms of the prophecy over my life from Prophet Querbus recently, he said to us that we will engage people of great wealth, even sheikhs, right? Of that caliber of, and we're going to position ourselves for it. We're going to think wealthy. Because they will not listen to you if they don't see some semblance of success, materiality within your life, okay? They're not interested that there's gold in heaven. Well, because their bathroom taps are made of gold. Right? Everyone say wisdom? There's a wisdom that we have, that there are principles of God's word we need to teach. But the way we present ourselves is going to open their hearts. If they see poverty come to them, they will say, your wisdom is despised because look at you. Right? Your wisdom is despised because look at your state. Okay, poor man's wisdom is despised. I want to say this to this house. God's going to elevate you materially, all of you. None of our young people here are going to be poor in the name of the Lord. You will not struggle, as some of your parents did. You will not struggle. Tell someone, and you, especially if you're sitting next to a young person, you will not struggle financially. You will not. And I want to encourage you, start to upgrade everything about you. How you present yourself, how you keep your room neat and tidy at home, does your house need a paint, for example? Will a king come there, or person of high standing? And so you have wisdom, but let me see, can I come to your home? When they come to your home, they see untidiness, they'll say, although you have great wisdom, no thank you. Simply because of what is presented to me. When the Queen of Solomon came to see Solomon's wisdom, you know what? 1 Kings 10, I don't know why, let's just go there. I see my notes here somewhere. I think it's 1 Kings 10. Just remind me, somebody. I don't have it in my note, but I think it's 1 Kings chapter 10. When the Queen of Solomon heard about the fame of Solomon concerning the name of the Lord, she came to test him with difficult questions. She came to Jerusalem with a very large retinue, with camels carrying spices, very much gold. Everyone say very much gold. There's very much gold and precious stones. You see, wisdom attracts wealth. Solomon prayed to God in the previous chapter. God endowed him with wisdom. She came to test him with difficult questions, but she came well stacked with gifts. Right? Tell someone, wealth meets wisdom. Right? Our prayer for wisdom is that God will bless us, but please remember, don't pursue wealth as an end for its own thing. It's a means to an end. And don't forget the end. You're focusing on the means and you stop at the money. The money is so that we can promote the message. It's two M's. Don't stop at the money. Don't forget the message. I don't want to be rich for pride or for ostentatious showiness or just to demonstrate, look what materiality we have. That would be vanity. That would be idolatry. That would be deplorable. But I want to get there so that God, your word, everyone say your word. Your word can find its way into new arenas, right? Because, you know, wealthy people shape policy. Wealthy people determine the structure of society, values and ethos, what goes and what does not go. And I sense very strongly in my heart, there are certain queens of Sheba, they're going to look for us. They're going to come looking for wisdom, right? It says kings, Isaiah 6, it doesn't say something that kings will come to the rising of your brightness. Rise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. She does not come empty-handed, the Queen of Sheba. She comes to Jerusalem carrying spices. Now, who needs your life to be spiced up a bit? With this and that, you know? I think South Africa got the best cuisine in the whole world. Honestly, I do. Certain countries have specific dishes that are really good. But I think just generally, overall, when I come back from an international trip, Renee knows, I want to smell the mutton curry from the gate. Right? Something about, especially Durban curry, it's like, not all South Africa. It's just, Durban curry is just an amazing thing. The spices, the blend, yeah, is just something unique. And so she comes to take the bland out of Solomon's life. Life is too bland for some people. She comes to give him some va-va-voom, some spice. She comes with specific spices. Solomon's cuisine would never have been the same for the rest of his life, simply because God gave him wisdom. Amen? Some of your diet is even going to change as the Lord blesses you. Amen? Amen. And then, very much gold, precious stones. When she came to Solomon, she spoke with him about all that was in her heart. Solomon answered all her questions. Nothing was hid from the king which he did not explain to her. When the Queen of Sheba perceived all the wisdom of Solomon, the house he built. So she moves from hearing to seeing. She says, you are wise, but what have you built? How do you live? What is the house that you have built? Verse 5, she observed the food on his table, the seating of his servants, the attendance of his waiters, and how they dressed. Tell someone how you dress is important. How you present yourself, right? Now she's got an eye for detail, this lady, and she's checking every detail out. What I want everybody to do, please go home today and start with your house and check out the details of your living room, your bedroom, everything, your yard. Take that weed out that's staring at you every day. Take it out today. Okay. Everyone say, note the details. Some of us got weeds growing in our gutters. Take it out. Everyone say, observe the details. Let me just say this to you. This is an apostolic spirit. Because the word apostolic, Paul uses the word, what's it? Sophis architecton, Sophia, Sophos, wisdom. And he said, I am a wise master builder. Right? Paul called himself wise. He said, I am an apostle. I am a Sophos architecton, is the Greek. Wise master builder. But wisdom, he used the word Sophos, Sophia. Wisdom, he said, when I even do the work of the ministry, wisdom governs me, right? I'm not here, there, and everywhere. I'm building systematically, sequentially, dotting my I's, crossing my T's. I'm building you, Corinthians, right? And I want us all to just exercise some keen observance to the detailed affairs of our lives. Are you going to do this? You see, because we're praying, Lord, give me wisdom, give me wisdom. When God looks at you, God can't see shabbiness and bless shabbiness with wisdom. Right? Tell someone, start somewhere. Right? Just start somewhere and do the basics and start to put things in place. When she came to Solomon's temple to see his wisdom, the food on his table, in other words, his diet, right, how he eats, the seating of his servants, the attendance of his waiters and their attire. When people come into this house to visit us at church, let's say, we must be so excellent from the time a person meets the first one of us from the car park all the way to the corridor into this venue. They must be gobsmacked by the wisdom of God. And it starts with how we present ourselves, right? How we showcase ourselves. Amen. Are you going to upgrade? Everyone say upgrade. Amen. Prophet Quilbus spoke about an upgrade, right? And I want to encourage you. Start with small things. The way in which you communicate on WhatsApp. Right? Some of us are poor communicators on WhatsApp. Some of us need to go back to school. Grammar. Punctuation. Okay? Hey, we're going to be the best WhatsApp communicators ever. Hallelujah. Right? A year or two ago, someone communicated with me on WhatsApp. And when I got this, I didn't feel like replying. I said, no, if this is the way you talk, I'm not going to waste divine energy on you. I thought, okay, let me be gracious. Let me practice mercy. And then I responded so excellently. Clinically, paragraph, full stops, exit, well spaced out, and I presented the person. That person's WhatsApp life was never the same again. I sowed a seed, and they changed, right? Right? An exclamation mark means you are shouting. You don't shout on WhatsApp. I don't know why I'm saying this. Not part of my notes. Right? Watch how you present yourself. Watch how you communicate. If somebody says, hi, how are you? Don't just respond by getting into business. Take the time. If they ask, let me say at least I'm fine. How are you? Right? Everyone say basics. If you're going to be wise at everything. Just present yourself differently. Amen? Present yourself differently. We train at the gym. I go there and I present myself amongst those that don't know Christ. We're in the mix. And they discern and they know that there's a difference here. You are not normal. You're not like everybody else here. The Son of God has been inserted into the system. Last week I trained and I was leaving. And I saw somebody that I befriended recently. And he was training on the other end. I was near the exit. I caught him while I was about to go down. I just ran quickly. And I came to greet you. How are you? And we fist punched. And I said, I have to rush. I got another appointment. But I just came to see how you're doing. And I was exiting. And he said, oh, you're rushing. He said, oh, you mean you just came here to greet me? I said, yeah. He says, yeah, you've made my day. You made me feel so, so special. Right? And this is a person not of our faith. Not of our faith. But he was gobsmacked that, and he knows I'm a pastor. And he said, you came to greet me. He was like, took him aback. You came to greet me. I said, yeah, how are you? Like for me, it's like normal. But for them, it's extraordinary. Your normal must be someone's extra. You must just function for you, being excellent, being wise, living with skill, everyone say with skill, living with skill in your life must be the norm. But when others see it that don't have it, for them it's, oh, what is this? You know what it does? It opens the heart to the message. It opens the heart to the message. Okay? Let's read on there. I don't know how we landed here. And his stairway, which he went up to the house of the Lord, there was no more spirit in her. Now, the last thing that impressed is a very important detail. His stairway by which his house was connected to the house of the Lord. He wasn't there doing his own thing. And notice everyone said the stairway. In other words, the house of the Lord was higher than his. He went up to, the Bible says he went up to the house. He put God above him because he knew grace flows gravitationally downward. So remember, one of the points in your house church notes this week was that your wealth is linked to your attitude to the house. Solomon got this right. He put the house of the Lord first. She was very impressed by the regimen of his arrangements, how his waiters stood, how they sat, the attire, how they served, the excellence with which things were done. But when she saw a stairway to the house, she almost died, brethren. Because if your spirit leaves your body, guess what? You're dead. And it says there was almost no spirit. She almost went to heaven. It's right there, right there. Maybe our wisdom will usher some people into eternity. When they see it, it's like gobsmacked, right? Almost fainted. And I want to encourage you, always keep the corporate culture of the temple, the house of the Lord primary in your life. And you'll see how God will bless you with his wisdom. Verse 10, verse 6. And she said to the king, "It was true the report which I heard in my own land about your words and your wisdom. Nevertheless, I did not believe the reports until I came, and my eyes have seen it." So, not my ears have heard it, my eyes have seen it, and behold, half wasn't told. You exceed in wisdom and prosperity. Wealth and wisdom, powerful duos, the report which I heard. Okay, the report which I heard. Okay, I didn't plan all of that, but that just, I think, was the Lord. Okay, I'm going to get into today's teaching. Amen. So you must give me an hour from now. I won't be that long, I promise you. Amen. I want to look at the case study of Solomon's prayer in detail this week and maybe next week as well. Although I had a very profound dream, I haven't even shared it with Renee yet. A very profound dream with Pastor Thamo in it, praying for me, laying his hands upon me, and cautioning me about something. It was in a meeting. I'll share those details with you later. Knowing people, you love news, so you must come next week. Must come next week to hear the details. But it was actually a word of confirmation about a session I needed to do with you in the matter of prayer, wisdom, and wealth. That is linked. The things he said, he came, we were in a meeting, church meeting, he was preaching, I was sitting front row, and before we exited, he came, laid his hands upon me and said certain things. And I got up with that this morning, got up, and I went to bed contemplating those things, meditating on aspects. So I know definitively God has spoken to me about a certain thing that relates to our marriages here in the house. That you and all the young people must be here for that session, because going to position us for great things, I believe, because God confirmed it. But until we get there, Luke chapter 2 and verse 52, the Bible says about Jesus that Jesus kept, increasing in wisdom. Now, everyone say he kept increasing in wisdom. This phrase characterized Jesus's growth and development. Yes, in stature, in favor, or grace with God and men. But wisdom was the first in the list here, even before grace, which is favor. We've often taught much about grace, but we haven't taught much about wisdom. But Jesus grew in four areas. Wisdom. And the word for grow here is interesting, or in this version, increasing. Now, it doesn't just say increased, but everyone say, kept increasing. So wisdom was a dynamic in which Jesus was consistently evolving in his growth from a little infant to 30 years old when he would start public ministry. This verse describes his growth as one that was consistently growing progressively in the quantum and the quality of wisdom that he possessed. And when I read this verse in the week and I was meditating on it, I really prayed to the Lord, Lord, let this be the feature of my life. May my wisdom never plateau, because wisdom never plateaus. May it always progressively be increasing on a consistent basis. The Greek word for this kept increasing is a lovely word, prokopto. Everyone say prokopto, right? Prokopto. Kopto means to strike away, to cut through or to strike away. Cut through or to strike away. The word pro obviously in Greek means before. Put the words together, prokopto means to beat or to drive forward, cut away forward, right? With repeated strokes. Everyone do this. Say repeated strokes, right? It's like you don't give up. It's like it's not just one, it's repetition. In other words, you don't give up. You are consistent in what you're doing so that the results will prove the fact that you were consistent. So there are certain things you need to consistently do to increase your wisdom. And I want to just instill, my heart this morning is to instill within each of you a desire to be wise and to grow therein. How many of you want to be like Jesus? Amen? Well, Jesus kept increasing in wisdom. If he kept increasing, if he prokoptoed, he repeatedly struck away forward with strikes and repeated blows, cutting away forward. I remember some years ago, a Greek theologian commented on this verse as a man cutting away through a dense forest, cutting trees away so as to make a way for others to follow. So he repeated repetition, strokes, cuts trees to carve a path so that others can walk on. The wisdom that you craft, the wisdom that you prokopto, will be the path of others to walk in. And sometimes maybe God will lead you into an arena not previously walked or traversed. But be brave and be strong as you increase in that wisdom. 1 Corinthians 1:30 says, by his doing you are in Christ Jesus, who has become to us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. Everyone say Christ Jesus, wisdom from God. Say it again, Christ Jesus, wisdom from God. Right? Who's living in you? Christ Jesus. In his earthly life, he kept increasing in wisdom. And that body of wisdom, together with his eternal knowledge, now resides in you. In verse 24, just back up a few verses earlier, it says, we preach Christ crucified, to the Jews a stumbling block, to the Gentiles foolishness, but to those who are called, both Jews and Greek, Christ, the power of God, and Christ, the wisdom of God. Christ is both the power of God, and Christ is the wisdom of God. Now, does Jesus, the Christ, live in you? Yes or no? Does the Holy Spirit live in you? Yes or no? The Holy Spirit is the spirit of wisdom and revelation. Christ is the wisdom of God personified, and that deposit, reservoir, or treasure of wisdom now resides in every single one of us. If he is in your heart, here's the thing I want to challenge you with. God wants that heart enlarged. Everyone say enlarged. God wants that heart enlarged so that the fullness of the wisdom that is resident there by Christ's presence, by the Holy Spirit's presence, fills out your heart to maximum so that you can manifest the wisdom of God. Now, look at the result of the reception of wisdom in Solomon. 1 Kings chapter 4, verse 29. In the previous chapter, he asked for it. Give me wisdom, God. God endowed him. When the writer of Kings comments on what happened to Solomon, he says this. Now, God gave Solomon wisdom and very great discernment and breadth of mind. Everyone say, breadth of mind. Like the sand that is on the seashore. Now everyone do say breath of mind. It's like Solomon's mind was so small. He himself said, I'm young, I'm immature, I don't know, I'm ignorant. Then the text says he got the wisdom And what does God do to the man's mind? Everyone say breath of mind. Would like breath of mind. Right? The King James, just the King James of this same passage, says it like this. God gave Solomon wisdom and understanding exceeding much and largeness of heart. Right? Everyone say largeness of heart. Right? Largeness of heart, or King James in the NASB, breath of mind. If you go to the next verse, leave the NASB up. Look at what Solomon did as a result. The commentary is this, verse 30. Solomon's wisdom surpassed the wisdom of all the people of the East and the wisdom of Egypt. I think we're frozen there. He was wiser than all other people, more than Ethan, the Ezraite, Hermon, Calcol, and Dada. Don't name your child Dada. And Mahol. And his fame was known in the surrounding nations. He also told 3,000 proverbs, right? 3,000 tweets this guy had for Twitter, for X. And his songs were 1,005 songs the man wrote. I don't think even Tommy Walker wrote that many songs yet. Okay, maybe he's on the path there. He told of trees, of the cedar that's in Lebanon, even hyssop that grows on the wall. He also told of animals, birds, crawling things, and fish. People came from all nations to hear the wisdom of Solomon, from all kings of all the earth who had heard of his wisdom. I really want to impress this upon your heart, because this I want to be the focus for your fast on Tuesday and Wednesday this week. You're going to come to God and you're going to say, God, I trust you for breath of mind. I trust you for an enlarged heart. I have so much capacity now, God. I'm able only to do X, Y, Z. I'm able only to think on this level. But God, I want you to enlarge my mind. Who believes God can do this? Let me just say this to you. Wisdom is, when you read the scriptures, it's a supernatural endowment. Something God can give you and lodge or deposit within your heart. I want to submit to the house. If you take this word and challenge seriously today, God's going to take that heart of yours and mind and give it breath. God's going to enlarge it. I said, God said, there's too much I want to pour in there right now. It's restricted. It's constrained. It's closed in. I need to enlarge it to give you the kind of wisdom that you need. And let me just say this to all of you. For your work context, for your work environment, where you work, the marketplace, I want you now to expect an intelligence that none of your colleagues can study for. This is not studyable. They're going to ask you, but how do you know? Tell me, where did you enroll for this? Where you get this understanding? Your response would be, it's given by God. The amazement of kings with the wisdom of Joseph, like Pharaoh to Joseph, Nebuchadnezzar, Darius, Artaxerxes, to Daniel, in the Babylonian context, they marvel at how these politicians and economists, Daniel and Joseph, politicians and economists, how they functioned, but they were sons of God in an evil system. And when they saw wisdom, they said, truly, your God is the God to be served, right? And they didn't have a band, they were not playing keyboards, there was no hype, there was no light, there was no drama. They were Monday morning in the workplace, and they put the wisdom of God on display. I want to submit to us, there's now coming a wisdom that's going to amaze your colleagues, amaze your family. Start to be a very serious problem solver. Does any of you have a problem at home that you can't solve? Who are you going to call? Not Ghostbusters. I'm saying start today. This is a problem, even something mechanical or physical or practical. And say, God, give me the wisdom of God to solve even something basic. Right? I solved a few things at home. Right? Lethal, will you be happy? But I still leave some things for him because some things are beyond me right now. Yeah? I want to encourage you. Some things are solvable if you simply think. Some of us are not thinking enough. We don't see the solution standing in front of us. Amen? So your capacity to be a problem solver is going to escalate. But God's going to broaden your heart, and God's going to, like He did Solomon. I mean, 1,005 songs. Jesus. Is there not even, if there's that many melodies, I don't know. Right? But the man thought of it, and he wrote, and he crafted those 3,000 proverbs, pearls of wisdom, some of it we're reading every day, right? A man whose mind was and heart was enlarged and extended by God. Psalm 119 says, verse 32 says the following, I shall run in the way of your commandments, because you will enlarge my heart. It's a very powerful passage, this. You know, Psalm 119 is a psalm about the word of God. Not so? We've sung about the power of God's word today. Let me just say this to you. When the word of God hits your heart, one of the effects it has is giving you breath of mind. You start to think on a different level. And I want all of you to start thinking internal enlargement. Everyone say internal enlargement. You see, you will never experience growth externally until you enlarge internally. The external will take care of itself. In fact, I believe external growth will respond to what's happening in your spirit. If there's enlargement in your spirit, guess what? Your external environment is going to have to recognize it, and they're going to have to conclude Errol is not the same. Something happening in his life. So Errol's world responds to what's happening internally in Errol's heart, right? You will never be the same. They must say, Siva, something's happening with him, right? Do you know environments respond to internal maneuverings of God inside of you? Yeah? Psalm 84, I don't want to go there now, but long teaching. Read it and study. You'll see the principle manifest there in the valley of Baca. Right? When they come, doesn't say God makes, when they come to a valley of Baca, which means weeping, depression, doesn't say God makes it a pool of springs. What does the text say? It says they make it. Some of us want God to do things when sometimes your environment will simply respond to what's happening in you. Things start to adjust. Amen? Things start to adjust. I will run in the way of your commandments. Put that verse up again. For you have enlarged my heart. The King James says it like this. I will run in the way of your commandments when you have enlarged my heart. When I am going to run. Come on, talk to me. When am I going to run? Only when there's an enlarged heart. There's no enlarged heart. There's no running. There might be crawling. There might be walking. But there's no running. Running speaks of, in terms of the physical body, the highest pace at which the human can move without any aid of any other thing is to literally run. It speaks of momentum. It speaks of acceleration. Now, I'm praying this week. I'm fasting this week, cutting everything aside. I'm saying, God, I'm going to declutter this heart of mine because I need to give you space. Everyone say, I need to give God space. I need to give God space. Please write that down. That's a word from the Lord. I'm hearing the Lord speak. God is saying some of your hearts are so cluttered, are full of the wrong things. I can't enlarge anything. So your word for this week is declutter. Get some things out so wisdom finds space to rest. Get some things out so wisdom finds space to rest. And might I prophesy over you, if you get this right, your momentum and the pace at which you maneuver into wisdom and wealth and prosperity will be greatly accelerated. I really believe this. So Psalm 86 and verse 11 says, teach me your way, O Lord, and I will walk in your truth. Unite my heart to fear your name. Everyone say, unite my heart. And speak about the heart a bit. You see, the heart can be divided. David says, in my own heart, there's division, God. It's pulled here, there, and everywhere. A lot of things vying for its attention. But God, bring it together to a singular focus. Unite my heart. Everyone do this? Right? I sensed this while I was typing up this note in the week. God said to me, tell your people, they're crying out for wisdom. I want to enlarge the heart to deposit, but there are too many things in the heart. The heart is scattered here, there, and everywhere. I need singular focus. Distraction, Pastor Thamo taught recently. Distraction is a serious ploy of the enemy. You've got to be focused, he said. Everyone say, got to be focused. And don't be distracted by happenings here, there, in this one's world, in that one's world, this circumstance. Just right now for this week and for the next few weeks, as you focus on prokopto, as you focus on cutting your way forward in wisdom, I want you just to factor and serve notice on anything in your heart that should not be there. A persuasion, a leaning, a proclivity, a bend, a weakness, a temptation, something you are pulled to that you know is not of God. A series you should not be watching on Netflix. Cut it out. You know those principles are antagonistic to principles of God's word. How can you want wisdom? And God says, but there's stuff in the heart. My wisdom can't even get in there. I want enlarged, but your people need to declutter. Everyone say declutter. Declutter. Right? This is very, very important. Ephesians 6 and verse 6b says, 6:6. The last part, doing the will of the Lord from the heart. The heart is going to be very important. You've got to have a heart of wisdom. Solomon had a heart for wisdom and it affected his mind. God gave him breath of mind, right? You've got to do the will of the Lord from the heart. You see, the reception of wisdom is so that you take this wisdom and the platform from the heart will be the venue from which you expedite the will of the Lord. You're not just doing things because your pastor asked you. You're doing things because you want to. You're doing things because it's from the heart, right? Colossians 3:23 says, whatever you do, do your work heartily unto the Lord. Everyone say heartily, right? If your heart is not in it, I would say don't do it. Only do it if your heart is in it. But the heart with which you do the work of the Lord and drive the purposes of God must be a heart full of the wisdom of God. I want to encourage the church to have a perfect heart before the Lord. Everyone say a perfect heart. 1 Chronicles 12:38 says, all these men of war who could draw up in battle formation came to Hebron with a perfect heart. Right? Everyone say a perfect heart to make David king of all Israel. This was David's third and final anointing. He was anointed first at Bethlehem in Jesse's house before his eight brothers. Years later, he was anointed by the tribe of Judah at Hebron, only one tribe. Soon after that, all the tribes came together. Everyone say, with a perfect heart. With a perfect heart to make David king. Perfection in the heart. Everyone say, perfection in the heart. If you want wisdom in the heart, strive for perfection in the heart. Because wisdom is not going to fill imperfection. I'm not saying being perfect as in flawless, right? The word perfect actually here means not perfect as you think of perfection. The word is salem. Everyone say salem. The word means full and complete. Everyone say full and complete. In other words, when these tribes realize, David, you are our spiritual father. David, you are our leader. David, you are king. There was oneness in all 12 tribes now. They come to David and they made him king with a perfect heart. You got to acknowledge who your spiritual father is with a perfect heart. Right? There must be no question. If you're going to go on this path of wisdom and wealth, God must ratify who your king is. Remember King's Oil, the old series we did? Whose oil flows on you, whose oil allows you to experience certain victories, right? A perfect heart. A perfect heart is full and complete. My prayer is, God, unite my heart to fear your name. Say this with me, unite my heart. Unite my heart to fear your name. I want to kick out anything that is taking up room, because God is saying, too many things are filling your heart, Randolph. Kick this out. Kick that out. Stop this. Stop that. Stop thinking like this. Stop striving after that. Because you want this wisdom you are crying for. I want to enlarge your heart. But I'm not going to enlarge it so that what is there finds greater room to maneuver and become a stronghold. Listen to me. This is the word of the Lord. God is saying to you, if there's something illegal in your heart, an attitude that is not of me, don't expect me to enlarge your heart, because if I do, the wrong thing becomes a stronghold, and the wrong thing drives you to a place of unrighteousness and disobedience. That's why this fast on Tuesday is going to be very important to me. Declutter. Everyone say declutter. Kind of consecration. God, make my heart perfect towards you. Look at King Amaziah, 2 Chronicles 25 and verse 2. He did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, but not with a whole heart. Very strange verse. The King James actually says he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, but not with a perfect heart. So the word perfect, shalom, salem, whole, complete, full, right? The New King James says a loyal heart, right? Old King James says a perfect heart. The NASB says a whole heart. Now go back to NASB. Is it possible to do something right but with an imperfect heart? Yes. You're doing the right thing. We can't fault you. You're politically correct. You're playing the part. You're ticking all the boxes. But your heart is far away. Heart is not in it. I'm preparing you to receive wisdom here, brethren, because when we receive wisdom, there's purpose to be done. But God said, I need the heart in a specific state. I need your people's hearts to be perfect in respect to you being a spiritual father. They must, with a perfect heart, make you king, in their heart at least. Right? With a perfect heart, they must obey you. With a complete heart, they must embrace the principles of the word of the Lord. Right now, let me just say this very clearly. God is judging political showboating. Externally, you are right, but your heart is in another place. Right? Some of you might be here, but your heart in another venue or another church. Let that not be the case. Right? But you'd rather be here, body, soul, mind, and spirit, fullness of heart. I hear the Lord saying, if wisdom is to escalate, wisdom needs a specific character of heart in which to grow and to develop. Unfortunately, if you know Solomon's end, wasn't too great. With all of this wisdom, what the Bible says about him. 1 Kings 11:4. When Solomon was old, his wives turned his heart away after other gods. And his heart was not holy or perfect. Yes, same word, Salem. His heart was not wholly devoted to the Lord his God, as the heart of David his father had been. Unfortunately, he had too many wives. My encouragement to all of you, choose one and stick with that one for the rest of your life. Okay? He had 1,000 women. Crazy guy. He had 700 wives and 3,300 concubines. That's 1,000 women in his life. 700 wives. Can you imagine 700 mother-in-laws? My mother-in-law is the favorite. My favorite mother-in-law is my mother-in-law. Let me just, for the record, say, clarify, lest I go home over the lunch table. Yes. I'm just joking. But she knows my heart. I'm saying, how are you going to deal with all these things? There's only 365 days in 1 year. You got 1,000, Lord, help her. Crazy guy. And in his old age, the Bible says, all these wives turned his heart away from the Lord, right? It's important to marry right, right? In fact, he violated the first law of Kings. in Deuteronomy is very clear there what kings should do and what kings should not do. God was very clear to them, you don't marry foreign women, you don't keep horses. This guy had thousands of horses. He started to violate principles. My fear, my biggest fear is this. And God said, help me not to go the route of Solomon, God. You gave the man an enlarged heart. You gave him breath of mind. He had cognitive capacity that any king in the earth in his time sought him out for. The Queen of Sheba came to him. His reputation preceded him. But at the end of his journey, he starts to drop the ball on certain basic fundamentals. And I want to encourage you. You know your biggest challenge is wealth. Don't think that because you're going to be blessed, so wealthy, that now you can start to violate principles. Do you know your greatest challenge is not poverty if you are poor? Your greatest trials will be when you are wealthy. Right? That's when the challenges start. In that time, my prayer, and make it be your prayer this week, say, God, when you do ultimately bless me, keep me humble. Let not my pride so escalate that I think I can violate this and that, because look, I am well stacked, I am secure in so many respects. Keep my heart pure and keep me humble. Now, look at 1 Kings 11, verse 9. Now the Lord was angry with Solomon because his heart was turned away from the Lord, God of Israel, who appeared to him twice. And this hit me big time. I went to bed with this verse on my mind. I was lying next to Renee and I was on my phone. She was in and out of sleep. She's saying, what you still doing on your phone? Just try and sleep. I said, I can't get away from the scripture. I was reading this scripture. It was quite late and the Lord was angry with Solomon because his heart was turned away from the Lord, the God of Israel, who appeared to him twice. Now, when did God appear to Solomon twice? Well, in 1 Kings 3 and in 1 Kings 9. In 1 Kings 3, 5, when he asked for wisdom, it says, in Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream at night, and God asked him, ask me what I will give you. That's the first appearing. When he built the temple and he had dedicated this with prayers, etc., in chapter 9, verse 1, it came about when Solomon had finished building the house of the Lord, the king's house, and all that Solomon desired to do, that the Lord appeared to Solomon a second time. Everyone say second appearing. Second appearing as he had appeared to him in Gibeon. Now, it seems as though, and the Bible says, look at 1 Kings 9 again, right? Sorry, 1 Kings 11. There's two chapters after this. When he gets all these wives and his heart is turned away from the Lord his God. Then it says, the Lord is angry with him, and the basis for the anger is, right? Just look back one verse, Gary. Oh, sorry, the next verse 9, you had the right one there. The Lord is angry with him because his heart was turned away from the Lord God, the God of Israel. Now, this it can be an innocuous statement. Who appeared to you twice? I'm angry with you. Why? I didn't come to you once, bro. I came to you twice with an open check. And is this your response to my twice coming to you? God smote, I must be honest, I felt like the smoting of the Lord in my own heart. God said to me, and I want to say this to the church as a challenge. Don't take for granted the appearing of the Lord to you. Don't take it for granted. Especially when it's recurrent. In his case, twice. Don't take for granted the fact that God speaks to you. I see how there's coming a subtle dishonor in this house with certain of our people. The word you valued before, it's no longer a priority. The service you would attend before, you can now easily miss because you've become too familiar. God is saying, your people despise the profundity of my speaking. It's a very dangerous thing. Very, very dangerous thing. I want to say further, I wrote it here in my notes, I had to type this up. Do not take for granted the profundity of the content of his speaking, the things that your ears are privy to hear. Solomon, I am angry with you because of the content of my engagement with you. You are not just another person. I selected you. I favored you. I gave you so much. I endowed you with so much. And is this your response? God is angry with the man because God appeared to him twice. God spoke to him with such profundity, with such profound context. And then thirdly, God said this to me, do not take for granted the uniqueness of my strategic placement of you in my overall plan. Very important. God's got an overall plan. He appears to Solomon twice, David's son, and he places him as a key role player in the broad scheme of things. God says, you despise that by your behavior. You take for granted how I endowed you. God smote my heart. Randolph, I've given you so much. You're favored in your strategic placement in the scheme of things. So if you're going to have this wisdom, which I will give you, I will enlarge your heart. But don't think that when you it's all said and done, that you can simply do your own thing. Consistently remain humble. And I want to encourage you all. God gave me a verse. I was trying to find it early hours of this morning. I got up and I knew it. And there are three occasions of it. Let me give you one. Psalm 50 verse 17. You would have read this in the Psalms. For you hate discipline. You hate discipline. And you cast my words behind you. Now this is like, have you ever taken something? Now I'm going to demonstrate this. What can I cast that will not break? This water. Let me cast this. It's like God says, you take my words and you cast it behind you. It's fine. Right? That's the impression. You receive so much and is this your attitude? You just take it. And for you, it's nothing anymore. Because you've lost its esteem. You've lost its value. You'll find this phrase many times, twice over in the New Testament, in the Old Testament. And God said to me, I said to God, Lord, I want wisdom, I want wisdom, I want wisdom. God saying, declutter, declutter, declutter. Right? Just clear out the heart space so because I'm going to enlarge your heart, Randolph, and the heart of your people. Then God says to me, if that's the case, do not disesteem how I appear to you. You are the son of Pastor Thamonaidu. Don't take that for granted. I've given you incredible and credible, awesome grace carriers as your oversight. Not many people have that. Don't take for granted. I have appeared to you twice. Right? Value what you have, Randolph. Not just that, you become a key role player. You're going to play strategic functions. Don't take that for granted. Don't take my word and simply fob it off. Think it inconsequential and cast it behind you. Everyone do this. Come on. Don't do this, brethren. You know, you just take it and you think nothing of it. Don't cast my words behind your back because I'm about to enlarge your heart. But if you are going to sustain what I've given you, I need you to be far more greatly focused, serious, and intense than you've ever have before. And let me just say this to all of you. If you perceive you get an iota of a temptation that's going to drag you away from purpose, deal with it. Wives, husbands, talk to each other. You see this in your spouse. Confront it and deal with it head on. Amen. My wife is good at these things. That's why I am like I am. Amen. I thank God for a daily. Because sometimes she can see a thing and I'm like, blasted. Watch out here. Okay, I've learned to listen. If you're sitting next to your husband, tell him, learn to listen. Wives, this is a good time. I'll give you some airtime here. Now, likewise, husbands, say this to your wife also. You too, my dear. That's all you need to say. Don't say too much. Just say you too, my dear. Right. 2 Corinthians 8, verse 16. Quickly. 2 Corinthians. Can I just have 10 minutes? then we'll be done, okay? Just 10 minutes and then we'll be done. 2 Corinthians 8:16 says, thanks be to God who puts the same earnest care on your behalf in the heart of Titus. Right? For he not only accepted the exhortation, but being more diligent, he went to you of his own accord. He did it heartily. His heart was in it. Context here, Paul sent his son Titus to Corinth because Corinth lacked the grace of generous giving. They were a stingy group. And he said, I will send Titus and he will complete this grace of giving in you. Paul said, when I asked him to go, he said, look at the previous verse, right? What God did to Titus's heart. God said, Titus, come here. This is the first case of open heart surgery. God said, Titus, bring your heart here. Open it up. I'm going to put something in there. It's called care for the Corinthians. Right? I'm going to make you, Titus, so love this group. Right? They're a hectic group. Paul called them saints, but you read the book of Corinthians, they were far from saints, brethren. Right? Paul had prophetic sight of what they will become. And God says to Titus, I'm going to put care in your heart for the group. Do you know God can put something in your heart that's not there? What is not there, God can lodge, God can insert, God can install. God can offload, God can EFT it, God can download it into your heart. Something's not there, then suddenly it's there. I'm saying to you this week, if you take this word seriously, your wisdom will be in another level because it might not be there, but God, it's going to be there because I'm going to insert it. There's going to be breath of mind, breath of heart. I'm going to enlarge the heart, and your people are going to start to run in the way of my commandments simply because of an enlarged heart. But let me give you a warning, and then we'll close. The warning is Psalm 106. I can't get away from this thought. I've appeared to you twice, and this is how you behave. You've accessed so much. You've been to so many conferences, Randolph, so many schools. In our case, apostolic schools of ministry. Not many people had the privilege you have. You know what the Bible says? To whom much is given, much is required. And, you know, there was a post I used to do way early in ministry. I remember it was one of my favorite posts to do, where I would focus on the words of Paul to Timothy, where it says, but you, O man of God. Remember? Everyone say, but you. You'll find it often in the books of 1 Timothy and 2 Timothy, a father speaking to his son, Timothy, but you, O man of God. Paul is saying to him, this, it might be fine for others to do X, Y, Z, but hey, for you, there are different requirements. The grandeur of your assignment, Timothy, demands different discipline, a higher level of discipline than other men of God. Other men of God, and you look at the context of both books, they can do X, Y, Z, but not you, Timothy. There's some borderline issues that some Christians walk too closely to, because it might not be construed as sin, but it's definitely going to take you away from your anointing. Some of us are walking, we see how close can we walk before we fall. I'm saying stay away from the boundary. Don't see how close I can come before I'm found out. Don't see how close I can come before I eventually fall. Simply stay away. Others, it might be fine for, but not this house, because there's a unique assignment here. And I'm saying the magnitude of the assignment demands another level of discipline, of rigor, of focus for this house. It's very, very critical. So here's the warning, Psalm 106, verse 7 to verse 16. Quickly. Our fathers understood not your wonders in Egypt. I think Moses was the author of this. They remembered not the multitude of your mercies, but provoked him at the sea, even at the Red Sea. Nevertheless, he saved them for his name's sake, that he might make his mighty power to be known. He rebuked the sea also. It dried up, right? He led them through the depths as to the wilderness, and he saved them from the hand of him that hated them. He redeemed them from the hand of the enemy. God's doing mighty works for Israel here. Verse 11, the waters covered their enemies, that's Egyptians, drowned in the Red Sea, and there was not one of them left. Watch verse 12 on, it's very critical here. They believed his words and they sang his praise. Everyone say it. Believed his words, sang his praise. Right? But sadly, they quickly forgot his works. You must never believe God's words, even excel in your praise and worship, sing his praise, but you come to a place of quick forgetting, sudden amnesia. You forget his works, and they did not wait for his counsel. Watch this. They forgot his work, did not wait for his counsel. Verse 14, they lusted exceedingly in the wilderness, and they tempted God in the desert. When you forget, lust finds new place in the heart. You mustn't have an enlarged heart for lust. You must have an enlarged heart for wisdom that obeys. Verse 15, the sad thing, they lust, he gives them their request. That's what you want, I give it to you, God says. You lust, I give you your request, but the result is a wasting disease upon their soul, right? Look at the King James. Or the New King James, I think one of them speaks to the issue that this was a leanness, yes, leanness. Everyone say leanness to the soul. Now, we're speaking enlargement, right? But this is the opposite. It's like God shrinks. God shrinks capacity. And I'm asking the church, I hear the, if you look at the next verse, they envied Moses in the camp, Aaron, the saints of the Lord. They start to violate principles of honor of leadership, and you read the rest of the psalm, a whole lot of things. And God said to me, some of you people cannot have the enlarged heart of wisdom because of the presence of lust in the soul, even though they saw my miracles, even though when they look back in their family's life or their personal life or even the life of the church corporately, They see how I dried up the Red Sea, how I brought them out of this, how I brought them out of that. But they're forgetful people. They got sudden amnesia. They forget. But what is eating away at their wisdom capacity is a lust, an unbridled lust for sensuality, perversion, sexuality that must be killed by its roots. Don't see how close you can walk to these violations without falling over the other edge. This is a warning to us all. I hear the warning of the Lord. Because Solomon had this problem. David had a semblance of it. It's amplified in Solomon. And it's manifested by the number of women in his life. And it killed destiny. God was so angry with him. God said, if you read the text, God said to Solomon, I will strip the kingdom away from you. But for the sake of my promise to David, your father, it will not happen in your time. It's going to happen in the lifetime of your son. And even then, when Jeroboam comes, your son, when he comes, I will not take everything away from him. I will leave him with Judah. But the rest of the kingdom will be divided for the sake of the promise I made to your father, David. Now, I'm saying this to you. God's program and God's purpose is going to happen with or without you, Solomon. It's going to happen with or without you, Gate DC. Don't think you are so strategic that everything hangs on you. God's saying, if you violate, I got promises made to fathers. Right? One way or another, it will come to pass. It's just that you forgo the privilege of being used in my purposes and in my plans. So they lust, everyone say, but leanness to the soul. The word is razon. In the Hebrew, it means thinness, skimpiness, scant. It literally means to be emaciated. That's why the NASB says wasting disease. When you have a wasting disease, it emaciates you, not so? You start to lose muscle mass, weight. You start to atrophy, right? You start to get thinness, skimpiness, scantness. Now, let me just say this. For some people in the realm of the spirit, That is exactly how they look to God. You can be fine externally, but what is your reputation in the realm of spirit? And I'm saying to God, Lord, do not send leanness to my soul. They lusted. The Bible says he gave them their request, but sent leanness to the soul. And when the soul is lean, your capacity to do God's will at any depth or level is significantly reduced. Because of time, I won't continue. A whole lot of other scriptures that bear the same kind of message and principle coming out here. I want you to stand before the Lord. Can the team please come up? We sing an old song, A Pure Heart, That Is What I Long For. Heart that longs for you. I want us to be serious today. I know time is gone, but I think this is the word of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord for us today. I want us to, we can respond initially now. I want you to take 2 days this week. Even in the business of your work, many of you work and you're focused. Try and pray often. Maybe go home and have a discussion this is a word, please hear this. All married persons, please have a discussion over this word today. And you ask each other, is there anything in your life that is bordering on you becoming a lean soul? We want to go this route of God giving us breadth of heart and enlarging our heart. But is there any kind of proclivity in you that you tend to, that maybe we can pray about or speak to or trust God for your deliverance in? Okay, this is going to be very, very key. Because I fear that if God gives us an enlarged heart without us having dealt with issues that crowd the hearts unnecessarily, that the wrong thing will have amplification, have a stronghold and new authority in it. So lift your hands to him. A pure heart, that's what I long for. A heart that follows heart after me. A pure heart, that's what I long for. A heart that follows heart after me. A heart that hides the world so that sin may not come in. A heart that's undivided would warn you, rule and reign. A heart that needs compassion, that pleases you, my follows heart. A heart that follows heart after thee. Oh, that's what I long for. A heart that follows heart after thee. A heart that hides your word. Thank you.
heart lift your hands, a heart that hides your word, Lord. Father, we lift our hands with our hearts as your word declares to you. We present our hearts to you for surgery. Declutter. Remove. Displace. Dislodge. Unearth anything, O God, that has lodged itself there as a stronghold. Father, we want to make room for you to extend the borders of this heart so that only your wisdom, which is pure, which is heavenly, not natural, not earthly or demonic, as your word declares, but which is heavenly, when it comes, it might find a fitting place, a place compatible its purity, Father, to lodge and to abide. And this is the subject of our prayer today, Father. We come to pray, and you said you will hear. You said if we ask for wisdom, you give generously. Even now, Father, we prepare the heart to receive generous downloads, generous deposits of the wisdom of God in the name of Jesus. Give to us generously. Forgive us, I pray, of any sin, any expression of unrighteousness with which we have functioned, any indiscretion, any outright blatant sin even, Father, we ask for your forgiveness. Cleanse us. Cleanse us. Let the cleansing power of the blood of Jesus cleanse every heart from every sin, I pray. The Lord forgives you, church. The Lord forgives you. The Lord washes you. The Lord cleanses you. Come on, lift your hands. Say, God, cleanse me. Cleanse me from hidden sin. Cleanse me from presumptuous sin. Just cleanse me, Lord. Cleanse me, Father. Cleanse me, Lord. Cleanse me, Father. Cleanse your house. Make our hearts clean before you, O God.
more time. I surrender. Jesus Christ. Whenever we do this, there's tremendous healing, forgiveness of sin, sanctification. Everyone say grace. This whole celebration ceremony is a transaction of grace. You receive something when you do it worthily. We remember the body of Christ, his historical body, but this body too, the mystical body of Christ, of which we are part and parcel. Receive his body and receive his blood and receive grace. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. See how I need wisdom. I read an article. I must try and find it somewhere on the computer. Jack Hayford, now deceased. Who knows Jack Hayford or knew him of him? Great scholar, theologian. I was actually talking to someone a month ago that was part of his network, a pastor in Bloberg Strand, Southwestern Cape, that heads his network here in South Africa. I love Jack. Got all of his books on worship on my shelf. Speaker of notes, erudite, way with words, great linguist, writer, orator. He wrote the song Majesty, Worship His Majesty. And he wrote, like Solomon, he wrote many, many songs. Many other songs commonly used today. But he wrote an article called My Wife, My World. Who would like me, wives, to send this to your husbands? My Wife, My World. And he gives account of Genesis account of Eve and all the Hebrew words of how God made and gave to Adam a gift, a treasure. In fact, the book of Proverbs actually says it, that your wife is a treasure from the Lord. I want us to really focus on our marriages. Right? Work through the issues. Get the victory. Become all that God has destined for you to be. Amen. We've determined this house must have strong marriages. For those of you that listened to my talk with the interview on the radio this week, that thing came up. So Lucana said to me, let's not preempt anything. Don't even prepare, Randolph. Let's just come and talk and see where this thing takes us. There was no plan for that day. Just come and let's see wherever the conversation goes. But God sovereignly just steered the whole thing to marriages. Amen. And so we're going next door, and we're also celebrating Rita's 60th, so we're going to sing for her next door. Rita, don't run off. Amen. So let's go next door and have some fellowship. Amen. And we're going to have a great time together. Amen. Bless you.
took